I cracked the lucid dreaming code, and when you do, understanding and having lucid dreams becomes so much easier. But in order to understand it, we have to go all the way back to 1848 and discover the strange tale of Phineas Gage. So picture this, it's 1848, a hot afternoon in rural Vermont. A 25-year-old man called Phineas Gage is working with his railroad crew. They're laying track, blasting rock, making way for the new railroad expansion. And Gage was more than just a worker. He was a leader, responsible. The people around him considered him reliable, someone who would get the job done. But on that particular day, something went terribly wrong. Phineas Gage's life would change forever in an instant. The explosives went off too soon, and before anyone could react, a 3.5-foot pole, 1.25 inches wide, went flying through the air like a missile. The rod entered through his left cheekbone and flew out the top of his skull. Can you imagine that? An iron rod the size of a broom handle flying directly through your brain. So most people wouldn't survive that, but Phineas Gage did. Not only did he survive, but he got up, talked to his crew, and then walked away. But the miracle of his survival isn't the strangest part. What happened next shocked everyone and changed neuroscience forever. Phineas Gage, the hard-working, responsible man that people knew, was gone. He was replaced with someone who was impulsive, profane, couldn't stick to plans. He was socially erratic and unpredictable. His personality had completely changed. But what's genuinely fascinating is, despite his injury, Gage could still walk, talk, and perform basic tasks. The important thing was his personality had entirely changed. Something profound was going on. It was Phineas Gage's injury that gave scientists the first clue that certain parts of the brain controlled who we are, how we make decisions, how we act socially, how we plan, how we think critically. The part of the brain was called the prefrontal cortex, and it's this part of the brain that holds the secret to lucid dreaming. So here's something curious. It might seem like Phineas Gage's experience is kind of extreme, but what have I told you? You experience this every single night. The prefrontal cortex of Phineas Gage was essentially destroyed, but when you're in a dream, a non-lucid dream, your prefrontal cortex is basically shut down. It may as well almost not be there. You're erratic. You're impulsive. You find it hard to think critically. You can't make plans. You take everything for granted. You act based on your emotions. And essentially, you've become like Phineas Gage. And this is all because of the prefrontal cortex. So what is the prefrontal cortex? The prefrontal cortex is the front of the brain. It's just behind your forehead, or forehead if you've got a big slapper like mine here. It's often called the control center of the brain because it handles complex cognitive tasks. Think of it a bit like the brain's CEO. It makes high-level decisions, plans for the future, and keeps our emotions in check. Without it, we'd be very similar to Phineas Gage. So here are some of the main functions of the prefrontal cortex. Firstly, there's decision-making, weighing up options, thinking logically. Here's a good example. Imagine you're going to buy a car. When you're doing that, you're thinking about the future. Will this be relevant in my life? Will this be useful for my life? Am I just going on impulse because I like the look of the car? Your prefrontal cortex stops you making impulsive choices and allows you to make logical, critical choices. You buy the car with the best fuel efficiency. You buy the car which is best value for money. You weigh up all the options. And then there's planning and goal setting. And this one should be pretty self-explanatory. You use this every single day. Today, you know what you're going to do for the rest of the day because you've made some plans. If you go to the shop, you know what you're going to buy. If you go on holiday, you have an itinerary that you decide upon in advance. This is also what we sometimes call prospective memory. The prefrontal cortex also helps with impulse control, so not acting on every feeling that you have. You've probably used this many times when your boss says something rude to you and you bite your tongue. When you see that extra slice of cake and you decide, actually, maybe I want to watch my waistline. That is impulse control. Another important function is emotional regulation, not having emotional outbursts all the time just because you feel a specific way. So for example, you're having a stressful time at work. Do you scream and shout and have a tantrum? Or do you stay calm and logical and get the job done? That's emotional regulation. Something a lot of people in YouTube comments are lacking. Another function of the prefrontal cortex is working memory. That's memory as you're going. So here's an example. If I ask you to write, Daniel Love is the best lucid dreaming channel on YouTube, 71893, in the comment section, you'll have to use your working memory to do that. And one of the most important functions is self-awareness and reality awareness. So not confusing reality and dreams, knowing who you are, that kind of thing. So basically, when you're awake, you know the difference between reality and dreams. But unfortunately, that's lacking in non-lucid dreams. So think of the prefrontal cortex as that part of your brain that says, stop. Wait a minute, does this make sense? Or stop, hold on, should I be doing or saying that? It's that self-regulating, logical, critical part of the brain. It is the lucid in lucid dreaming. It is what the word lucidity means. Okay, so let's get practical for a moment. I want you to think back to the last dream you can remember clearly. What I'm actually asking here is for you to grab your dream journal. You absolutely should have a dream journal. And to look through it. As you work through that dream, I want you to think of all of the functions of the prefrontal cortex that we've just discussed and look for ways in the dream that they're missing or lacking or diminished. Those are essentially the clearest possible dream signs, the true clues that you're dreaming. Or in other words, the biggest dream sign, the biggest clue that this could be a dream right now is that your prefrontal cortex isn't holding the reins. That is the number one thing you should always be looking out for. So far, we've discussed the story of Phineas Gage, what that tells us about the purpose of the prefrontal cortex. We've also learned that in our non-lucid dreams, we're very similar to Phineas Gage because our prefrontal cortex is mostly deactivated. But how do we use that information to crack the code of lucid dreaming? How do we use it for practical application? And that takes us neatly on to cracking the code of lucid dreaming. So here's something I'm asked almost all the time, whether it's in YouTube comments or from my tuition students. They say something like, I'm doing all the training, but I don't feel like I'm doing it right, or I'm worried that I'm not doing it correctly. Well, this is where cracking the code of lucid dreaming comes in. First, we need to ask, what is a lucid dream? And from everything we've discussed so far, it should be relatively clear. Oftentimes people use words like awareness, but they're very nebulous terms. In practical, physical terms, a lucid dream is a dream in which the prefrontal cortex is active. It isn't active in non-lucid dreams. When the prefrontal cortex is active, that critical thinking ability is available. And then we can ask the question, hold on a moment, could this be a dream? And then realize we're dreaming. So a lucid dream is essentially a prefrontal cortex dream with the knowledge that you're dreaming while you're dreaming. So in order to crack the code of lucid dreaming and to put aside any worries that you're doing your training wrong, we need to understand how all of the individual steps for lucid dream practice relate to the prefrontal cortex. And one way to do that is to think of lucid dream training, the various different practices you do, as exercises in a prefrontal cortex gym. So let's first look at dream journaling. Dream journaling is an incredibly important core practice for lucid dreamers. Most people think it's just a way to remember your dreams, but there's much more to it than that. When you're writing down your dreams, you're engaging in working memory, a prefrontal cortex activity. This allows you to hold information in your mind, to analyze it, and to use it. And if you hold information in working memory, it will transition into long-term memory. So over time, building this muscle helps you to remember your dreams in the long term. But it's not just about memory, it's also about self-analysis. When you're going through your dream journal, when you're looking at last night's dream and analyzing it, looking for inconsistencies, you're teaching your brain how to analyze things, how to think critically, how to look out for dream signs. And over time, as you build this ability to spot inconsistencies, you'll start to do that in your dreams as well. In other words, the more you dream journal, the more you're prepping your mind for lucidity. And just like poor Phineas, you're laying down the tracks for your brain to follow when you're dreaming. So now let's move on to reality tests. A reality test is pure prefrontal cortex thinking. Not only are you testing reality, analyzing the nature of reality, a prefrontal cortex activity, you're also engaging in critical thinking. And those are the two most important factors for the mindset of a reality test. What we're really doing is learning to punctuate our thinking with moments of prefrontal cortex activity. But it's not just assessing reality and engaging critical thinking. Prospective memory or planning also comes into the mix, another important function of the prefrontal cortex. Every time you wake up and start the day telling yourself, I'm going to look out for triggers for reality tests, you're engaging planning, prospective memory, a vital element of prefrontal cortex activity. The particular tests that you do, whether it's a nose pinch test, a digital watch test, or even something unreliable like finger through palm, are less important than the mindset. And when I say mindset, what I really mean is, are you using prefrontal cortex function? And one prime example of that is how you respond to the test. So let's say you've just pinched your nose and tried to breathe through it, and you could breathe through it. Are you going to critically assess the answer, or are you going to be impulsive and just shrug it off? If you're acting impulsively, you're not engaging the prefrontal cortex. Another important lucid dreaming practice is intention setting. So what is that exactly? It's planning and focus, two prefrontal cortex functions. So when you're setting an intention, what you're really doing is asking yourself to remember to do something in the future. So that is planning activity. You're setting yourself a goal. And this is why it's really important to remember that intention setting is not the same as repeating a mindless mantra. Unless you find that a mantra helps you to remember to do something, unless a mantra helps you to plan, mindlessly repeating something is not the same as planning to do something in the future. Intention setting is no more mysterious than planning to buy milk at the store and acting upon that plan. It's a simple, everyday example of prefrontal cortex use. You can do it right now. Here's an example. Set the plan to hit the like button and comment at the end of this video. If you can do that, then you can use intention setting for lucid dreaming. Is lucid dreaming awareness? So awareness is a word that's thrown around a lot when it comes to lucid dreaming, but it's probably the wrong word for lucidity. So let's think back to Phineas Gage. Poor Phineas was unable to have lucid dreams. Why? Because he was lacking a functional prefrontal cortex. When people ask the question, can everyone lucid dream? We have at least one example of someone who couldn't. But Phineas was not unaware. He wasn't lacking awareness. He responded to the world around him, often erratically and full of emotion. It was not a lack of awareness, it was a lack of prefrontal cortex function. And you're the same. In your non-lucid dreams, you're not lacking awareness, you're lacking a particular type of critical awareness. You respond in your non-lucid dreams, aware of everything going on. If you're being chased by a monster, you're aware of the monster and you're aware you should run. But you haven't engaged prefrontal cortex activity and ask yourself, hold on a second, is this even possible? There's a phrase I throw around a lot, and most of my students will have heard this. We need to be lucid about lucidity. When I say that, what I mean is that we need to engage prefrontal cortex logic when it comes to lucid dreaming. When you're learning to lucid dream, The number one thing you should do is to use all of your prefrontal cortex functions as you're learning and in all of the practices you're doing. Always ask yourself, is this helping me to train my prefrontal cortex functions? Lucid dreaming is not awareness. Lucid dreaming is not mindfulness. Those two things are far too nebulous and apply to way too many functions of the brain. Lucid dreaming, when boiled down to its nuts and bolts, is the activity and the functions of the prefrontal cortex. If you want to crack the code of lucid dreaming, the question you should ask is always, is this training my prefrontal cortex? So if you're ever in doubt, go back to the section of this video which explains the functions of the prefrontal cortex and run your training, run your practices by that. Analyze whether or not what you're doing aligns with prefrontal cortex activity. And by a strange twist of fate, you will be being lucid about lucidity when you do that, because in order to do that, you are engaging your prefrontal cortex. When you look at Phineas Gage, you realize that self can continue if changed, even if a large part of the brain is lacking. So what exactly is self? Well, you'll find out the answer to that in this video just here. I'll see you there.